Welcome to worship. We're so glad that you're here. Thank you for being patient with us with those tech issues. There was no internet for a little while, and so that made live streaming difficult. So whoever is tuned in to worship today, go ahead, type a little comment in there. Let us know who's with us, how you're doing, where you're worshiping from today. We would love to hear from you. Okay. Today, in our scripture readings, we'll hear that the prophet Amos calls for justice to roll down like waters. Paul urges us to encourage one another with the promised coming of the Lord. Jesus tells the parable of the wise and foolish bridesmaids. Surrounded by the faithful of every time and place, we celebrate Christ's coming in our midst in the word of life and the feast of victory, the marriage feast of the Lamb. This morning, we gather in the name of the one who creates, the one who liberates, and the one who heals. Amen.
We move on with the call to worship. Loving and transforming grace, source of creation, who some know as God, be with us now. Some have experienced moments of rejoicing, for blasting shatter, for a sense that our chosen candidate has prevailed, and some may be in deep mourning for the loss of the person we supported and believed in, so that now we are in the pit of despair.
How do we become united once more?
On this day, on all days going forward, let us look to ourselves, into each other's eyes, to the skies, as we recognize that we must find ways to join together as never before if we are to build the future we dream of.
Now we'll join in our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Sadly, we have denied the goodness of your creation and our own goodness as persons made in your image. We have abused your good creation, wounded and rejected each other, and mistreated ourselves. Forgive us, merciful God. Give us the courage to embrace ourselves, each other, and all that you have made. Teach us to be better stewards of your good creation, following the example of Jesus Christ through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door to us. through Jesus, you are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. And now our prayer of the day. God of all nations, Father of the human family, we give you thanks for the freedom we exercise and the many blessings of democracy we enjoy in these United States of America. We ask for your protection and guidance for all who devote themselves to the common good, working for justice and peace at home and around the world. We lift up all our duly elected leaders and public servants, those who will serve us as president, as legislators and judges, those in the military and law enforcement. Heal us from our differences and unite us, O Lord, with a common purpose, dedication, and commitment to achieve liberty and justice in the years ahead for all people, and especially those who are most vulnerable in our midst. Amen. And now we'll hear a solo from James Blackie.
Thank you.
morning. First reading is from Amos chapter 5, verses 18 to 24. Alas, are you who desire the day of the Lord? Why do you wait the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light. It is as someone fled from a lion, and it was met by a bear, or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. It is not the day of the Lord, darkness, not light. And gloom is no brightness in it. I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies, even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings. I will not accept them, and the offerings of well-being of your fattest animals I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your song. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. But let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like ever-flowing stream. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, Cross family. The second reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, verses 13 through 18. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. This is the word of God.
And we'll now have our gospel acclamation. God is so good. Please rise if you're able.
Today.
We give thanks for this Sunday. We give thanks for this opportunity to wrestle with where we are as a nation. But also, God, I ask that you receive the meditations of my heart, and that the Holy Spirit guide the words that have been inspired by the prophet Amos for me to speak a truthful and prophetic word to you, the community today. Amen. I feel like, on the one hand, I'm like just completely jubilant about where we are post-election this Sunday. But on the same hand, I also am sad in one way about the fact of the reality of where our country is, having gone through this election, realizing how deeply divided we actually are as a nation and as people, and not just people in this world, but in particularly as people of faith. And so we know that there is much to talk about, as this has been quite the week for everybody. And I know it's not just those of us who live in the land of the United States of America, both continental and otherwise, but also for those of us who have connections to people around the world. I was getting texts from many people in Messenger chats from my friends in Europe and in Central America and Mexico about the outcome of this election. And I won't necessarily share what everyone said, but I will say that there was a tenor of hope in the messages that were sent from my friends with respect to how this election would impact not just us, but the world. And so, having said that, I also imagine that there are many folks out there today, those in our own city, in our own state, and across the nation, that have been grieving for the past 4 years and now may be extremely jubilant today. But I also recognize that folks who may have been extremely jubilant for the last 4 years now may be mourning and grieving today. But I want us to focus first on the lesson that we heard this morning from 1 Thessalonians. And I'm going to sum that up in saying, we do not grieve as those who have no hope, for everything is transformed. And if you would go down further in verse 18, there you would see how encouraging these words are for us today, and also were for a particular person that I recall, because in reading and trying to figure out what I was going to say today, there was one theologian, James Howell, who talked about one of the mystics that those of us who study religion are quite familiar with, called Julian of Norwich. She was a mystic in Europe, and in particular in, I believe it was England. And we know that her life was very tragic. She was wrestling with a lot of pain and visions about the sin that was going on in the world. And she said that at one point, Jesus actually, she felt, came to her and told her, in the midst of all that she was experiencing, that all shall be well. In fact, all manner of things shall be well. And it might seem naive today to sum up the gospel lesson as all shall be well, because a lot of times when you hear that, it is accompanied by that kind of trivial spirituality that a lot of people love. Like, a lot of people come to church on Sunday that they just want to get warm fuzzies. They just want you to preach something that lifts their spirit and makes them feel good, whether that's really telling the whole truth or the intersections of our faith with society where we live. They want everything to be good, that life should be sweet, and that tomorrow will be a happy day. But Jesus said this to Julian as she wrestled with the stark realities of suffering and sin in society. She lived in a small brick cell in the city of Norwich during the Great Plague of Europe. More than half the population of Norwich perished during this time, It also, at the same time, the Hundred Years' War was simultaneously raging across Europe, and the worst schism in history was tearing the church apart. And isn't that interesting? Because when I was reading all of this, it eerily sounded like us today. Sheltering in place for almost 9 months, wearing masks and physically distancing for who knows how much more time, probably at least another 9 months. And steadily seeing every day when we turn on the news or turn on our TV or look at our phones, some kind of little thing scrolling across telling us how many people were infected today, locally, nationally, or globally, with the coronavirus. And then we see the global death toll rising every day. In such a terrifying, insecure, bleak time, Jesus told her, and Jesus tells us, and those who will listen, all shall be well. All manner of things shall be well. So that's a comforting message, and I want you to hold that as the frame as we get ready to dive in, because I gave y'all a hint that most of my sermon was coming from Amos, and y'all know Amos was no joke. And so I'm going to read to you from the Living Bible. You heard from the NRSV translation today earlier, Amos, but I'm going to read it one more time. You say, if only the day of the Lord were here, for then God would deliver us from all our foes. But you have no idea what you ask, for that day will not be light and prosperity, but darkness and doom. How terrible the darkness will be for you. Not a ray of joy or hope will shine. In that day, you will be as a person who is chased by a lion and is met by a bear, or a person in a dark room who leans against the wall and puts their hand on a snake. Yes, that will be a dark and hopeless day for you. I hate your show and pretense, your hypocrisy of honoring me with your religious feasts and solemn assemblies. I will not accept your burnt offerings and fake offerings. I will not look at your offerings of peace. Away with your hymns of praise. They are mere noise to my ears. I will not listen to your music, no matter how lovely it is. I want to see a mighty flood of justice, a torrent of doing good. Now, this is the good word from Amos for us at our appointed lesson today. And now, this might surprise some of you that this particular Bible verse is one of the ones that the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. quoted the most often. But let justice roll down as waters and righteousness as a mighty stream. Now, y'all know folks didn't take too kindly to the warnings and the truths of Mr. Amos any more than they did of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. But the prophet Amos had a prophetic word indeed. And he was saying, as most of the Hebrew prophets were saying, that what God wants is justice and right living rather than religious rituals or ceremonial posturing for their own sake. It is not enough to simply do church and act as if society is somehow separate and devoid of the word of the Lord. Amos makes it plain so even a six-year-old can understand it, that if we simply do church and ignore the injustice in our society, it is too weak to say that we disappoint God. Amos goes on further to say that God finds a church like that disgusting. Did you hear me? Disgusting. In fact, the Lord says, I don't want your offerings. I can't even stand the noise of your hymns, your praise songs, or your heavenly organ preludes. If you don't want to do justice, then get your pew-warming bottoms out of my house. Now, of course, I paraphrase, but that's basically what is being said. Justice and righteousness. Those are two words that are in that verse. And there are two words that appear often in the Bible. but often many people misunderstand what they mean. When we hear the word justice, what do we think of? Anybody, there's like four people here, y'all, who are in my virtual world. What do you hear when you think, when you hear the word justice, what it comes to mind? Jail. Anybody else? Fairness. Okay, I'll take jail and fairness, which is real interesting because they don't always seem to go together right now. But when we hear the word justice, and I'm right there with you, we may think of a criminal getting the punishment they deserve. People say, I just want to see justice done. But the Hebrew word for justice is mishpat, and it has its root meaning in fairness and equity. When it is applied to criminal cases, justice in the Old Testament means that the judge does not take bribes. The judge is not swayed by popular opinion. The judge does not treat the poor worse than those that have all the privileges, which would be the rich, and who can sometimes, oftentimes right now, influence the judicial system. Most of the time, the word mishpat has to do with justice for those we might call underprivileged, or those living with disparities, the undocumented immigrants, the homeless, the essential service workers like the fast food workers, the hotel domestics and housekeeping, the clerks at our Targets, Walmarts, Walgreens, and all those places, the working poor and the poor that can't even be seen. These were the people in their society who had no power. They lived hand to mouth all the time. And if there was a famine or invasion or a decline in the economy, they were the ones to suffer first and the most. In the Torah and in the prophets, God makes it abundantly clear that just letting these people suffer with benign neglect is not merely a lack of love or mercy, it is in fact injustice. If we leave the poor poor and do nothing about it, then we fail to do justice. So let us go back to the Psalms and take a lesson out of his book, Psalm 146, which describes God of Israel, saying, Yahweh executes justice for the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. Yahweh sets prisoners free. Yahweh gives sight to the blind. Yahweh lifts up those who are bowed down. Yahweh loves those who live justly. Yahweh watches over the immigrant and sustains the orphan and the widow, put in the homeless and the poor and the addict and whomever else you want. But God frustrates the ways of the wicked and the evil. Since antiquity, it has been portrayed that the gods were identified with the ruling class, the rich, the powerful, the kings, the queens. But in Israel, from the foundational document of the nation in Torah, their constitution, God who rescued the slaves made it perfectly clear that God was on the side of the poor and the vulnerable. True prophets of Israel, like Amos, reminded the people that God was on their side against the rich and the powerful who tried to take advantage of them. I think that this time, in this particular time where we find ourselves, the poor got the message. I'm not so sure that maybe not since the 60s or perhaps even after the Great Depression have the poor voted where they actually understood that their vote was the vote that made the difference. Normally it has been the middle class and the wealthy that sort of battle it out. And so whatever happens, the poor are still in the same category as they were before. But this time, the poor's voice was heard and it was made clear. And so when this God called for justice, he wasn't talking about protecting the rich from the poor. God wasn't talking about protecting the native born from the immigrant in their midst. On every occasion, the Lord speaks about justice as protecting the poor and the immigrant, along with those that would be the least in our economy, the least in our streets, the least of our country, who were in trouble in a society rigged toward people who were wealthy, rich, and could care less about those at the bottom. A constant concern in the Old Testament is that the rich have the ears of the judges, while the poor do not. It would seem that history has been repeating itself, and this is too also in this day and age, in 2020, still an injustice. Now, we know that injustice isn't equally distributed, is it? It stands to reason that injustice is easier to perform against people without the money or social status to defend themselves. The poor are more often the victims of robbery, one of the most common forms of injustice. And ordinarily, law enforcement is much quicker and more thorough in its response to violence against the rich and powerful than it is against the poor who can't afford to be robbed. The other word that I want to address, because I think I've made my, I hope I made my argument about injustice pretty clear, that it all goes way back to antiquity. But the other word that Amos and Dr. King pair with justice is righteousness. When we hear that word, we may have negative associations from the idea, because often when we hear in our modern day context righteousness, it also, it usually has another word right before it. And that word is called, it's a four-letter word, self. That's right, self-righteousness. But even when we hear it as a positive thing, we probably think of it in terms of a personal morality of sorts, maybe being honest, being sexually pure, whatever that's supposed to mean, or thrifty, or brave, or clean, or reverent, but some kind of moral code or tense is attached to that, right? But the Hebrew word tzedakah is something very different. In the Old Testament, it means something more like living in a right relationship, treating everyone with fairness, generosity, and equity. So we see that the difference between justice and righteousness may be that justice is about making things right that are unfair in our society, and righteousness is about doing right, treating people right, and especially those that are most vulnerable. Justice is more about legal and systemic problems, and righteousness is more about good deeds and acts of generosity, or what we like to call random acts of kindness these days towards those in need, which would mean everybody, because at some point in time, we all need an act of kindness, yes?
Yes.
And so when these two words, righteousness and justice, are tied together, as they are over three dozen times, that's 36 times. The English expression that best conveys the meaning of this is social justice. So Dr. King's favorite verse says that what God wants is for justice to roll down as waters and righteousness as a mighty stream. Amos could have said he wanted justice to roll like a river or like a sea, but he chose the word waters. Why? Because he wanted to suggest that the waters above in the creation story, those waters that the firmament keeps away when the sky is open, the waters come down like a flood. Dr. King used the King James phrase as a mighty stream, but the Hebrew doesn't mean mighty, it means everlasting. It contrasts to most of the rivers in Israel that are dry in the summer and run with water only in the winter or rainy season. Righteousness is to be an ever-flowing stream. Righteousness is supposed to be everlasting. There is no end. So you see, Amos' oracles announce that Israel is on the verge of being wiped out by God because there has been no justice for the needy. Insert the United States. In chapter 2, he says that they sell the righteous poor for silver and the needy for a pair of shoes. In other words, they sell people into debt, slavery, for owing as little as the price of a pair of shoes. And I'm not talking about Jordan or Allen Edmonds shoes. That is not what I'm talking about. Or ladies, Charles and David. That is not what I'm talking about. In other words, they sell people into debt, slavery, for owing for a meager pair of shoes. Think about $40. In general, they are trampling the poor into the dust of the earth, and then they push the disabled out of the way, and they prostrate themselves before altars, meaning that they lay down on the altars of money and gold, but they are laying on the garments that they have taken from the poor as collateral. something that was prohibited in the Torah, the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, since antiquity. They drink wine that has been bought with the money that they took from the poor as fines, which reminded me of the practice in Ferguson of how the government there would take money from the poor and fines rather than to raise property or income taxes of those who were wealthy enough to own their homes or major property. There's something wrong with that dynamic, and Ferguson isn't the only place. In chapter 5, Amos says that these people hate the ones who reprove them. They abhor the one who speaks the truth. For example, Amos, and sometimes even a modern day preacher. The judgment coming is that these people will never live in the fancy houses that they built. They will never drink the wine of the vineyards that they have planted and harvested. Why? Because they trample on the poor and they place taxes on those who can least afford it. They prosecute the innocent, they take bribes, and they ignore the needy. This is coming from Amos, from the Old Testament, y'all. This sounds like it's coming right out of modern day history in our own context right now. This is one of the reasons we call it the Living Bible, because it is telling us the truth, and we would only open up our eyes and open up our ears to listen and to hear and to see what's going on right in our very midst. Can you hear these words and still believe that the tax policy and the criminal justice system are political issues that don't belong in the church? They are the issues on God's very heart, then and now. Stop taxing the poor, the Lord says, and instead take the tithes from the rich to support the poor. That's not some politician. That is the God of Israel. Stop sending the poor to jail and letting the rich go scot-free. And in fact, monopolizing profit on the very pipeline of their sending the poor to prison. Stop letting your judges and government officials take bribes so they will push the needy aside. When I am hearing this from Amos, I can't help but link wealthy Americans who pay lobbyists to make sure that their states do not provide Medicaid to more people, that they're trying to break down the Affordable Care Act to make sure that the working poor remain uninsured. And if you don't believe me, then just come here to Cross any day of the week, but preferably Monday through Friday, and you will see those who are coming here to the free clinic, or go to Elmbrook on Green Bay and Silver Spring, or go to Walker's Point, or go to 16th Street Clinic. These are all right here in the simpler part of our city. Wake up. And do you think that Amos would make a distinction between a bribe and a campaign contribution? Not when they serve the same purpose. In Amos, there is a particular verse, verse 13 in chapter 5, that seems so apropos to us. Therefore, the prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil age. How incredibly brave was Amos to be so sarcastic and snarky with his people of the time. This was the way most of the temple people thought. It was an evil age. So it was only prudent to keep silent while the evil were in charge, because there could be fatal consequences for speaking out. Interestingly though, in some circles, even in our time, there are clergy folk who have been told to keep silent about social justice because it's just too political. Y'all may recall that in the past, before our current Pope, and I claim that Pope too, Pope, but the Pope spoke to Congress and said, I don't take advice on economic policy. This is what one of the congresspersons said. I don't take advice on economic policy from the Pope. Perhaps you ought to stay in your own lane, preacher. But Amos, the lay preacher, is like that memo went into the circular file, which is known as the garbage, and said this: the prudent will keep silent in an evil age, but friends and foe, prudent I am not. I have a word from the Lord to shout loud and proud. Hate evil and love. in equity and justice. This is modern day Amos, of course. Perhaps we preachers have been too prudent for too long. The time has come for us not to play it safe and to hold back, but get back in touch with what first called us to serve the church in the first place, to bring the passion, to bring the anger, to bring the truth. The church has enough ministers, both ordained and lay, who want to hold the status quo until we shrivel up and die. Maybe that's why the mainline churches today are dying. Just maybe we can let go of that other stuff that keeps the church stuck. We can have a transformation that breathes new life into us and into others. The church does not need any more ministers who want to maintain the church and stay on the sidelines. We need ministers who will stand up, speak out, and advocate with the people. Be outside more than you're inside in these walls. The church does not need us to play it safe any longer. God needs all of us, the insiders, the outsiders, those on the sidelines, those on the main line, the traditionalists, the agnostics, the wildlings, the rich, the poor, the outspoken, the reserved. There is a place for everyone. The church cannot afford to exclude anyone any longer. It is ironic that these days on Sunday mornings, our sanctuaries are looking pretty empty, with observing, of course, best practices for one another and for everyone. But it also made me wonder if this too, in the midst of all the chaos that we have been experiencing, was a wake-up call that the work for people of faith is not just inside these beautiful stained glass buildings, but to be out in the world that can be dirty, it can be filthy, it can be snarky, it can be all sorts of things that do not reflect these beautiful stained glass windows and pristine white walls. But it is where our voices, our bodies, and our heart need to be if we're going to be on the line for equity and for justice. The church can be an electric gathering if we believe that what we do makes a difference. Love makes it easier, and hope carries us forth. Surely evil has been overcome and can be overcome by living like Jesus and showing back up like Christ. So meaning that we need to get in there like Jesus and be ready to die, but knowing that we will come out on the other side all shiny bright and adorned because we've done what the Lord has asked us to do. I'm almost there, y'all, but I figured post-election sermon needed to have everything in it that I could get. Commentator Carla Wirtz suggests that our parable in Matthew teaches followers of Jesus the importance of not just staying woke, but rather to be vigilant. And by doing so, we then understand that in uncertain times, it shows us we are able to endure to the end. Our lamps will continue to be lit. The teaching of the wise and the foolish maids builds on the previous teaching of the wise and the foolish servants. You see, Jesus had to keep going because we still hadn't gotten it right. Both parables illustrate the need to live in a manner that expects the return of the Lord, even when the return is delayed, because the folks of Matthew thought he was coming like this. The parable is summed up in verse 13. In this parable, the bridegroom's arrival was certain. The uncertainty of the timing illustrates the need for constant vigilance. Back in the day, you remember that there were dowries and all these things that came up, so there could have been some last minute discussions which delayed the bridegroom from coming. Coming he was, but maybe there had to be a few things that were put into place. And so we're told that we need to always be vigilant, be patient. The earliest readers of the gospel had already entered into the dark days after the crucifixion and resurrection and had begun waiting for Christ's return. Maybe we too are waiting for Christ to show up yet again. But in the meantime, this parable challenges them and us to be vigilant and to live in anticipation of the Lord's coming. To live in vigilance, meaning for disciples, we need to do the tasks that have been appointed for us to do in preparation for the Lord's coming again. Matthew's good news for us is that these tasks include bearing witness to God's kingdom by welcoming the stranger, which is today in our midst the immigrant, most commonly the undocumented immigrant, feeding the hungry, visiting the sick and in prison, and making disciples in all the world for justice and equity. We know this is a time where we may want to sit down and rest and be satisfied, because Lord knows we're tired. Everybody's tired. And I agree, it is a time to take a time out, to pause, to take it all in. But then we have to regroup and get back to business, ensuring that the Affordable Care Act is more robust and accessible to everyone. That we need to get back to believing in science and let science do what science does. We need to advocate for Black Lives Matter and for immigrants. We need to advocate for ecology, not just here, but across the world, and be back into those agreements with other countries in the world. And we need to fight for a livable wage for all of our people. And we need to bust that pipeline prison, because we know that that is not about justice or equity. But in the meantime, as we look at what our agenda is still calling for us to do and to continue to do, we must be committed to not be satisfied or content, because that's what got us into the place we are in now. We cannot rest until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream to destroy these evils that have kept us shackled like slaves. Yes, all of us shackled like slaves, whether it was because of the greed or because of what greed did to those who were the oppressed. The fierce urgency of now is still upon us. So let us remain vigilant, because there is justice and equity to do. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Michelle, for that amazing prophetic sermon. I brought out my pen to take a couple notes, and hopefully I'll be able to still read whatever I'm supposed to say, because it's just full of notes now. We're going to hear, say that again,
we changed the song.
Oh, we changed the song?
After that sermon.
After that sermon? Oh, well, you know, we're calling an audible, and we're going to hear a different song, and we can't wait to hear what it's going to be.
Okay. If I shall not be moved, after that sermon, I felt that we needed to go back to that. So anybody here that knows I shall not be moved, please feel free to join in.
Jesus is a girl in the bush.
Thank you, Dr. Rose. Gathered together by the love and grace of God, let us pray. Loving God, our Creator, we give thanks for your awe-inspiring creation and the glimpse into who you are that the many different cultures, creatures, and landscapes offer. At the same time, our hearts are heavy when we look around and see the way your people and planet are used and abused for the sake of profit. Motivate more people to create positive change that values the sacredness in all of your beloved creation. Inspire more politicians and business owners to have a triple bottom line that focuses not only on profit, but also the well-being of your people and your planet. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. Loving God, our liberator, we pray that you will liberate every mind, body, and spirit of the things that are not life-giving. Help us to remember who we are and whose we are, so that we may also go and remind others of their work. Let us dream bigger dreams together and envision a better future for all people. Strengthen us all for the road ahead as we participate in the life-giving work of liberation and reconciliation. Open more eyes to the lived realities of the poor and oppressed. Multiply our efforts as we work together to address the sins of racism and white supremacy and thwart the plans of any who seek to do harm. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. Loving God, our healer, we ask that you work through medical professionals, counselors, and scientists to bring healing, and especially for people with COVID-19 and other diseases. This year has been a year full of grief, from the loss of our usual way of life and comforting routines, to the loss of jobs and the ability to gather together. There is much for us to grieve. For all those feeling weighed down by the amount of upheaval and change this day, and for all those mourning the loss of dear loved ones on top of it, God, we ask that you bring them comfort, peace, and the reassurance that comes from knowing Jesus will always sit with us in our grief, and the Holy Spirit is always as close as the breath in our lungs. On this day, we pray especially for family and friends who are mourning the loss of Asha Young Doherty. Lord, in your mercy, receive our prayer. God, we thank you for the technology that allows us to unite to worship you. We pray for all those who gather online near and far, knowing that the ground between us is holy ground. Here, other prayer requests may be offered both in person and online in the comments section. We pray especially for Regelina, Riley, and family, Roscoe and Cynthia Munger, and the Munger family, Bonnie and Lula Williams, and the Williams family, the Bugelman family, LaVon, Richie Hayes, Eddie Dunn, and Jenny, Edwin Eaney Munger, the Huber family, Julie Jackson, Demas Jackson and the Jackson family, the Acevedo family, the Carl Carlson family, the Ingram family, the Miller family, Ed and Deanna Williams, Kurt Klaus, Will Gladwig, Kamhua and Conrad, Terry and Sam McGee, Gloria Wright, Steve Eckley, Judy and Johnson Hunter, Sally Biddy, Janet Williams, John Darren and John Walker, Tracy Harris and Wayne Pratt, June Torrance, Kaylin and Kevin Blackwell, Chrissy, Raylan and Kai Brown, Kenny Murray, Fran and Olivia Love, Deanie Claiborne, Cheryl and Viola Lee, Aroma and Bobby Riley, Craig and Tricia Dent, Carl and Dolores Bain, Val D. McCollum, Esma Mitchell, Audrey and Danny Bain, Paul Craig, Betty Miner, Larry and Sharon Adams, Mother Adams, Ola Reddick, Ricky Bear Davis, Max Bodenbach, Rosalind and Tara Luce Schaffner, Reverend Marilyn Miller, Reverend Mary Martha Kennis, Reverend Chris Marion, Reverend Lindsay Winkleman, Reverend Delaney Schlake-Cruz, Reverend David Dragset, Reverend Jess and Matt Short, our partners in Pastoral Transition, Reformation Lutheran, and Christ Presbyterian. We also pray for my candidacy mentor, Pastor Jerry Lamb and his wife, Kim, who are both battling COVID at this time. We pray that they will be healed. And we'll see what else we have from the ministry. Oh, from Cynthia Munger, we also see that we'll pray for Chantel Page. She's home, and we'll pray for her family and her caregivers. Also from Cynthia, her mom's brother Kenneth had a mild stroke last week, so we pray for his wife and son as they are the caregivers. And then let's see what else we might have in the live stream today. We have prayers, additional prayers for Sally Jackson and Lawrence Middleton, for Sheila's grandmother who passed away very early this Saturday morning, for Alice Rodriguez, Sarah Boyce, and Brooklyn Love, for Elaine Fernando, who's suffering her fourth round with cancer and is alone in the hospital right now. For these things and all the silent prayers in our hearts, Lord, in your mercy, we ask that you receive our prayers. At this time, we'll have our offering prayer. We want to thank everyone for the ways that you share your time, talents, and treasures. We thank you for any gifts that you submit online, as well as those that you mail to us that keep all these vital ministries going, even in the midst of the pandemic. So thank you so much. We offer everything that you give here now on the altar for God. God of all goodness, generations have turned to you, gathered around your table, and shared your abundant blessings. Number us among them that as we gather these gifts from your abundance and give thanks for your rich blessings, we may feast upon your very self and care for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our sovereign and servant. Amen. God is with you.
And also with you.
Let us lift up our hearts.
We lift them to our God.
Let us give God thanks and praise.
This is a good and joyful thing to do.
It is a right and good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give you praise, all-loving God, creator of energy and matter, heaven and earth. Therefore, we celebrate you, joining our voices with the wind and the streams, the animals and flowers, the living and the dead, the stars and the planets and all the company of creation, who forever sing their unending hymn to proclaim the glory of your holy name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. Having given thanks, he gave it to his disciples when he broke it and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it and he gave thanks. Then he gave the cup to his friends to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this also in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and we drink from this cup, we proclaim the mystery of the Lord until he comes again. And now I would invite you, for those of you who are in your individual pods at home or here in the sanctuary, to hold hands as we pray the prayer our Father has taught us. Whose Father? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I now would invite you to remember that there is a place for you at the banquet, for this table is the Lord's table, so everyone is welcome to come and feast. Now at home, I would invite you to take whatever it is that you're using for communion this morning, to also distribute to your loved ones at your house and any visitors. And you have our pre-made kits to also use those as well, and we will be communing here. Fortified through the blood and the body of Christ. May it strengthen you during this time of rest and pause for the next level of the journey that we all must get out there and work for equity and justice for everyone, as it's appointed through the prophet Amos as the mandate of the Lord. Amen.
Communion prayer. Lord Jesus, in this simple meal you have set a banquet. Sustain us on the journey. Strengthen us to care for the least of your beloved children, and give us glad and generous hearts as we meet you on the way.
and now receive the benediction. Grant, O God, that your holy and life-giving spirit may so move every human heart, and especially the hearts of the people of this land, that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatred cease, that our divisions being healed, that we may live in justice and peace and equity. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, let us all say, amen.
You have come, you have heard, you have listened. May your understanding cause you to respond. Go forth into the world and dare to make a difference. Amen. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. May the peace of Christ be with you always. Take a moment to share a sign of peace with someone today, whether it's in your home, whether it's via text message, email, tweet, post, or phone call.
Peace. Peace, everyone. Peace. Announcements.
Okay. Does anyone have any announcements that you'd like to make before we officially close out today? Feel free to submit those in the comments section.
We would like to lift up that the service for Ashe Young Riley will be at Ebenezer Church on MLK Drive, and the visitation will be from 10 until 12 noon. And then the service will be from 12 noon until 2, with the repast immediately following. I should mention that there will also be one of her best friends that was also killed in the accident, so it will be a double service at Ebenezer Baptist tomorrow, beginning at 10 for visitation and 12 noon for the funeral.
Thank you, and I don't see any more announcements in the live stream, so we just want to say God bless all of you, and we pray that you experience God's peace as you go about your week. Take care.